Hello, my name is Julie Black-Peart, and I will be your host today for Health Center from Downstate Medical Center. Today, Ms. Lorraine Brooks from Downstate Medical Center, and we're going to be discussing today gambling, how problematic it can be, what some of the signs and symptoms to look for when people have a gambling problem. And we just want to touch on some of those things and enlighten the general public about what to look for. So welcome, Lorraine. How
Thank
are you today?
Thank you, Julie. I'm good. How are you?
Good. I'm doing just
nice
fine.
Nice to be back on the show with you.
Yeah. Nice to see you too. It's been
Thank
a little
you.
While.
It has been indeed.
Okay. So let's start out by letting our viewing audience know exactly who you are and what you do, and then we'll get into it.
Okay. Well, I'm the director of the Employee Assistance mm-hmm. Program here at Downstate. And that means that I see a lot of people who have personal issues that might impact their job performance, or even personal issues that don't necessarily impact their job performance. But sometimes people just need a place where they can go and talk in confidence and discuss whatever's going on in their lives. And so I provide some counseling and some referrals, and it's a good service for people who are in need of just counseling or somewhere to go.
Right, and that's very important, because a lot of times people have issues going on, and when they're afraid to speak to family members, their clergy or whatever have you, because they feel ashamed about something, they really do need some place to come and a person to talk to about these issues and get to the bottom of them so that they can have a good function to their lives. Mm-hmm. And touching a little bit more on that, the subject we're going to discuss today, gambling, can be very debilitating for people at times. And I think that maybe our viewing audience might not really realize just how debilitating it can be. And it is actually a disease. I want to take just mm-hmm. a moment to read a little bit something. What is problem gambling? And basically, it's gambling to the extent that it causes emotional, family, legal, financial, or other problems for the gambler and the people around the gambler.
Mm-hmm.
Problems with gambling can worsen over time, and gambling problems can range from mild to severe. So perhaps maybe we should talk a little bit more in the beginning about how this problem is diagnosed, and a little bit about what kinds of questions we ask in order to find out.
Well, you know, you used a word that is absolutely the perfect word to use, and that is debilitating.
Yeah.
People, I think, don't really, well, first of all, let me go back by saying gambling is now a part of the DSM-5, which is the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of the American Psychiatric Association. And that's the manual that's used to diagnose all substance abuse and,
right.
and mental health behavioral problems.
Right.
And compulsive gambling is listed under the category of substance-related and addictive disorders.
Right.
And it's listed as a non-substance-related disorder. So it's different from a substance-related disorder in the sense that you're not taking something into your body.
Mm-hmm.
You're not ingesting something that's causing right. you to behave a particular way. But it's considered an addictive behavior because it has the same qualities as an addiction.
Right.
You're doing it more than you really wanted to, and you're not realizing it. As you say, it progresses over time. It gets worse.
Right.
You find yourself engaging in it more than you originally had planned to do. It has a lot of the same features
right.
that an addiction has. And like any other addiction, it can impact your life in very negative ways.
Right.
So I think debilitating is the right word. Socially, certainly financially.
And emotionally.
Certainly emotionally. Many people isolate when they gamble. It's a very isolating activity.
Yeah, because they get ashamed because they know that they're doing something that they ought not to be doing.
Yeah, but even the act itself, I mean, mm-hmm. even when you think about it, let's say, for example, a group of you and your girlfriends mm-hmm. decide you want to go to the casino one night.
Well, that's just the girls
hanging
out.
Right. Okay. So here's five of us, and we jump in the car, and we go to the casino.
Right.
And you say, okay, I'm going to go play the poker machine. And I say, okay, I'm going to go play the slot machine. And somebody else says, okay, I'm going to go play roulette.
Right.
And we're there together, but we're not at all together. We're all focused on whatever it is we're doing.
Right.
So in that sense, it's very isolating because it's not a social activity.
Ah.
You know what I mean?
I would think that perhaps with a girls group, say for instance, we all decide to play with the one-hand bandit mm-hmm. and we pick a couple of chairs together, or we choose a table and play together. But what you're saying is that when people have more addictive style behaviors, that they actually like to isolate themselves. Perhaps is that because maybe they don't want other people to see quite how involved or engaged they are in the activity?
How much money they're spending.
Right.
Right. Or how much, what we talk about when we talk about these behavioral addictions, or what they call process addictions. They're not substance related, but they're behavior related. And what we talk about is the person gets what we call a rush.
That euphoria from winning.
Yeah, not necessarily from winning.
No.
No. That's interesting, because the rush comes from the act of doing it.
Or gamblers, the chance that they expect they might get.
No.
Not quite. See?
Not quite.
That's what most people probably think.
Exactly.
Okay.
And that's why it's good to talk about this, because it's really, it's kind of hard to understand on that level, because it's really about what gamblers call the action.
Mm-hmm.
You don't even have to win. It's not about winning, and it isn't really even for a compulsive gambler.
Yes.
Uh-huh. It's not even about winning or the money.
They just
it's about that rush.
Yeah.
That same rush that you hear people who use cocaine.
Okay.
Or some other stimulant. And you know, you see somebody who uses cocaine, and they get that thing, you know, and it wakes them up, and it makes them.
It gets their happy hormones going.
Exactly.
The same endorphins.
Mm-hmm.
We call those endorphins.
Serotonin,
right, and everything.
And all that, dopamine, and all that good stuff.
For our listening public, those hormones are hormones that are released in our brain that give us that sensation of euphoria, happiness, excitement when we engage in some level of activity.
That makes
us feel that, because more of it gets produced within the brain.
And exactly. And when you that's what exactly an addiction is.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
It's you're flooding your brain with these neurotransmitters like serotonin and dopamine. Those are the two major ones. And those are the ones that make you feel good. So anything that you can do that will produce dopamine is going to make you feel good. And it could be anything.
It could be
money. It could be payday.
Eating.
You know you feel better on payday than you do the day before payday when you get that money. It's money is a mood changer. Just like
cigarette smoking.
Cigarettes.
Any form of anything that can be habit-forming. Sex.
Shopping.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Yes, for shoes, right?
By the way, I love your shoes. I meant to tell you that.
Yes, thank you.
But yes, and that's the thing.
It
really gets that, like you say, those feel-good hormones going.
Yes,
but it's a very gambling is a very it's about the rush. It's about the action of doing it.
Yeah.
Whether you win or not, I'll tell you a story. The first time
I really got
interested in addictive gambling was, oddly enough, I was on a conference that was talking about addictions. And where was the conference? It was in Atlantic City.
Of course.
This is going back probably about 20 years, when Atlantic City was first coming up.
Really getting, popular.
And we had this conference in Atlantic City in the Trump World's Fair, or casino, which is not even there anymore. But I went to a workshop, a seminar on compulsive gambling. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that the person giving the workshop said, and I never forgot it, and I went right from there to the casino to see whether or not what he was saying was true.
Oh, must have been very profound.
It was very profound, and here's the thing, and we just talked about it. Mm-hmm. When you see somebody who's really a compulsive gambler, it is so not about the winning or the losing or the money.
Mm-hmm.
It's about that person getting that rush.
Right.
Okay, so we leave that workshop, and I'm thinking to myself, that's really very interesting, and I knew nothing about gambling.
Mm-hmm.
I go into the casino, and I'm just observing people, and sure enough, there was a man who was playing a 25-cent slot machine, and he won a great deal of money. I think he won like $40,000 or something.
Wow, really? A 25-cent slot machine?
On a 25-cent slot machine.
That's playing it low on your risk.
We'll talk about that in a second. He won this exorbitant amount. It must have been the major jackpot on that machine, to the point where people came over to him, and they were taking his picture,
and they
made a big deal. The casino made a big deal about him. Okay. And all the time that all of this was going on, people are applauding and congratulating him and smiling and big things going on. And that man's expression did not change.
He was staunch.
He was staunch. He was just like, okay, let's get this over with so I can get back to my machine. And sure enough, as soon as everything calmed down, it took about maybe a half hour before everything really calmed down. Everybody left and they paid him off and whatever. And he went right back to that slot machine.
25
and his
cents.
Face did not, his expression did not change. And I thought to myself, wow, that's really telling. Mm-hmm. If I had won $40,000, I'm gone.
You'd be like,
I'd be like, you know what? Okay, let's sit, you know, let's go. I got bills to pay. I got it.
Yeah.
And if you won the same thing, what happened to you? But this guy was like, you know.
That's for us when we decide that we want to go take a trip to whatever casino or, you know, engage in some sort of a gambling. We're going for just the chance of it, perhaps. I know myself, I'm not particularly fond of watching any money go into a machine where I don't have a guarantee that something's
going to come back.
Out. So thereby, you know, most people don't really engage in this type of activity, but you would be surprised really how many people do. It's taken off exponentially.
Absolutely.
We do have a lot of new gambling outlets here in New York. Mm-hmm. We've got the two major racetracks in the area.
Right, we've got Aqueduct and Yonkers.
But then we've got Atlantic City, which has taken a turn. We're seeing these major casinos that are closing down. They had just opened a big, huge one last year, and
Revel.
Yes, it's already closed. Right. And we have to ask ourselves, well, what is the reason for that? Let me just digress for a second. Because what I'm thinking about, when people have to, when people are diagnosed, oftentimes it comes to the point where either family members or friends or themselves finally get to the point where they realize, I have a problem. All right? And how do you know that you have a problem? I'm just going to read off a couple of questions because there are a lot of tools that we have at our disposal for diagnosing, including the DSM criteria that you mentioned earlier. But some of the questions that we have to ask ourselves are, have you often gambled longer than you planned? Have you often gambled until your last dollar was gone? All right. Have you used your income or savings to gamble while letting bills go unpaid? And finally, I'll just pick one more. Have you broken the law or considered breaking the law to pay for your gambling? And I know that's going to lead us into a whole nother area because it becomes such a serious thing that people do sometimes break the law.
Absolutely.
So go ahead, pick up from there.
Well,
there's a lot of directions you can go.
I'm telling you, you just really laid it out. Let me back up one second before I go into that.
Sure.
Like any other addiction, one of the major features of it, not diagnostically, but, well, actually maybe diagnostically, one of the major features of it is denial.
Yeah.
People who suffer from these diseases are usually the last ones to know.
Absolutely.
Or the last ones to acknowledge. Mm-hmm. So we get very few people in treatment, and there is treatment.
Yes.
But we get very few people in treatment who self-disclose, who come forward and say, geez, you know what, Julie, I think I have a gambling problem. Mm-hmm. It's more likely to come from the family.
That's
the
true.
Loved ones.
That's true.
The people who see your behavior is affecting the family or your finances.
Right.
Usually it's finances.
Yes.
And when you mention illegal activity, it's gamblers are notorious, and I don't want to give them a bad name, and I'm not, you know, because I'm very sympathetic, obviously, but gamblers are pathological gamblers,
of course.
Not just gamblers, but pathological gamblers.
The ones with the problems.
Mm-hmm. Are notorious for being for illegal activity, check forging, embezzlement, using other people's funds,
stealing.
You know, emptying bank accounts, college funds, all those life insurance policies. And that's usually when the family, when those things start happening, that's usually when the family and the friends get alarmed, and rightly so.
Various fraudulent activities that allow them
to get a hold of money, whatever
they can get it,
right.
Even if that's obviously the sacrifice of, like you said, their own family and their children. I know, oddly enough, as a physician assistant, a lot of these types of issues can be treated in a family practice setting. When people come and they don't present saying, you know, I realize I have a gambling problem, they may present with depression or anxiety or various other forms of mental illness that you have to then talk to your patient or client and eke out what the issue is, right?
Which is where those screening
tools come in. Yes.
So uh-huh. handy, because mm-hmm. they're convenient questions that you can ask people, mm-hmm. Like, have you gambled more than you originally had planned?
Sure.
You go in with $100 and you end up going to the ATM and taking out another right. $100 right. or whatever. Or have you gambled for longer periods than you intended?
Right.
You know, when you say, well, I'm only going to go to the casino on Saturday, and then you end up right. being there two or three times
right.
a week. When you are finding yourself having anxiety when you're not doing it.
Right.
And see, that's a big thing.
That's what I'm talking about with the anxiety.
Yes, that's yes. exactly very similar, again, with the dopamine and the endorphins. Mm-hmm. Very similar to when you're not drinking and you get shaky, or when you're not mm-hmm. having a cigarette and you get a little anxious. It's the same
right.
thing.
Well, they lose sleep over it.
Absolutely.
They absolutely dream morning, noon, and mm-hmm. night about, when's my next opportunity to get back mm-hmm. to the casino? Mm-hmm. And then when they have these other problems, they're constantly worried about the bills not being paid. Mm-hmm. But at the same token, they're deliberately not paying bills because they have to have that extra little bit of
correct.
Funds in order to spend in the hopes that they're going to make it big.
And win back the losings.
Right. I mean, the average loss. Person or the casual mm-hmm. gambler goes to the casino. They plan to spend, let's say, $150. Mm-hmm. And if they lose that amount of money while they're down there, that's it for them.
That's
you know,
it.
I mm-hmm. set my losses, I set the bar, and I'm fine with that. And then mentally, they can walk away with it without mm-hmm. any issues. Mm-hmm. But the person who's compulsive and has an issue, they can't do that, right? So
that's
their
right.
ability to turn that off has been lost.
Exactly.
Right?
That's
and
exactly
then so
right.
it's the family that pushes them to go see their practitioner and go get help and some counseling, mm-hmm. wherever it is that they go, because as you said, there are treatment options for these mm-hmm. these individuals.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The thing about the first of all, it's not only casinos. I think you have some lottery tickets here and that I just want to mention uh-huh. that.
Yeah, these are just some of
It's not only casinos. It's the lotto.
The lotto.
Which you can get pretty much anywhere.
Pick 10, pick 5, pick 4, pick 3, pick 2, pick 11, pick 149,
whatever it is,
yes,
right?
Yes,
and it's all very enticing
yes.
because the jackpots are huge, you know, $550 million.
It'll be that one in however many
and, you know, and the
folks.
Slogans are brilliant, aren't they?
Gotta be in it to win it.
All it takes is a dollar and
a dream.
Right? Mm-hmm. What are they saying now? Hey, you never know.
That's right.
And those slogans are designed. They're really good slogans.
No, they are.
They're designed to get people to think
yes.
that it's going to happen
to
them.
Yeah.
You know, because all you need is a dollar. But the fallacy in that is people spend a lot more than a dollar.
Yeah, they spend. If the game is a dollar for two chances or whatever it is, they're mm-hmm. buying more. And mm-hmm. nowadays, if you really take a look, the tickets are, whether it's a scratch off, what they're $5 a ticket, they're $2
a ticket,
they're $20.
Tickets.
It's yeah. crazy. And if you go in there yeah. and you buy a few of those, and if you're playing some sort of numbers game, the lines are so long when the jackpots get huge, and people are standing there and they're like putting in, oh, I'll take this number or that number, and they're rattling off like 10 yeah. different numbers, and they've got the dream book and the whole nine yards, and then they saw the what do you call the lady who you go to talk
oh,
to,
the fortune teller lady, right,
uh-huh. right to
yeah.
give you
these
advice.
Are your lucky numbers.
This is your lucky
you know,
numbers.
You saved the thing out of your fortune cookie in the Chinese restaurant. These are your lucky
yes,
numbers.
Yes,
yeah,
yes.
A lot of it is superstition.
Yes, moon and the stars.
Right. A lot of it is feeling like you're lucky. You know, luck
yes.
is a very strange thing
yes.
because there's really no such thing as luck, you know.
Right.
And as a matter of fact, let me just say this.
There's a little bit of luck that fella you have.
Well, another clever way of getting separating you from your money, as my father would say. Luck is a funny thing.
Yes.
When you play slot machines, here's something I learned about slot machines, mm-hmm. which people probably should know.
Okay.
People who play slot
Enlighten
machines.
Enlighten us all.
When you slot machines have reels, mm-hmm. right? And the reels go around, okay. Mm-hmm. There could be three reels, there could mm-hmm. be four reels, there could be five reels, there
all
could
right.
be more. Each time that reel goes around, there's a certain number of symbols on that reel.
Right.
There's a cherry, there's a lemon, there's a watermelon, there's a star,
there's
a seven, there's an X,
yeah, whatever.
So let's say the reel's got, let's say it's got 20 symbols on it.
Mm-hmm.
And in between those 20 symbols is space.
Right.
Okay. And then the next symbol has, the next reel has 20 symbols, and in between the symbols there's a space, and
right.
the third reel, same thing. So you have three reels,
uh-huh.
they all have the same symbols,
right.
and the same spaces.
Uh-huh.
Okay. So here you are, you press the button, the first reel stops, it's a red 7, the second reel stops, it's a red 7,
uh-huh.
the third reel stops, and the red 7 stops just
right.
one little
oh,
thing with that, and you
darn.
Think to yourself, oh boy, I almost... You know, I almost hit the jackpot.
Yes.
And they want you to think that
mm-hmm.
because it looks to your eye like you almost won.
Yeah.
But the way the slot machine is in between each of those symbols,
uh-huh.
it looks like there's only one space, but there's in fact probably about 10 spaces.
Really?
There's probably about 10 places where that wheel could stop
uh-huh.
in between that 7 mm-hmm. and whatever the next number is.
And you don't see it because
you
it
don't
goes
see
around
it.
So
well,
fast.
Not only do you, but you don't, your brain doesn't process that.
It.
Your brain sees the 7 right there. It sees one 7 there, one 7 there, and one 7 mm-hmm. a little bit to the above it.
Mm-hmm.
And your brain processes that as your one step off. But in mm-hmm. fact, there could be 10 places where that wheel could stop.
Right.
That would not be your 7.
See, it's truly a psychological game.
It's totally a psychological
game. The people who develop these games do an exorbitant amount of research
Absolutely.
In order to figure out how to get to
they
your psyche.
They know exactly how your brain
to
works.
To keep you going.
Yep.
All right? It's like the
yep.
nicotine in the cigarette
yep.
That makes you, like you say, constantly think that you've got this wonderful
mm-hmm.
chance
you
of
just,
possibly winning.
Right.
Yeah.
And every time you push that button,
mm-hmm.
now it's a button. You don't even have
yeah.
to go like this anymore, right?
Well, it could be a slot
Which
machine.
Is faster.
It could be a roulette
it could
wheel.
Be a roulette.
It could be the cards.
And anytime you on a slot machine, anytime you pull the thing or press the button, however you do it, every time you do that, you have exactly the same chance
right.
of winning.
I mean, right.
Exactly. Your odds of winning do not increase the more you play. And that's another fallacy people have.
Mm-hmm.
They think the longer I play, the greater my chance is of winning.
Okay.
The more money I spend, the greater my chance is of winning. And it's totally not true. In fact, it's quite the opposite.
So before we run out of space and time here,
oh, okay.
let's just touch on something. What should people do if they have a family member or themselves feel or come to the realization that they have a problem?
Well, you know, the same way that we tell people with any other addiction. First of all, if you feel that there's someone in your family or a loved one that you feel is suffering
mm-hmm.
from any kind of addiction, you have to be very careful how you approach them. What we tell people is to not accuse the person of anything, not try to diagnose them, don't go wag your finger at them
right.
and say, I think you have a
that
problem.
Will create more of an
that
issue.
Will create defensiveness and you don't mm-hmm. want the person to get defensive.
Mm-hmm.
What you have to do is you have to use what we call I statements. I am worried about you. I have noticed that you're spending a lot of money in the casino. I feel that you're taking time away from our family and our
right.
children, and it's making me worried and upset about you. You have to keep the focus on you and tell the person how their behavior is affecting you.
Yes.
That takes away their defensiveness, and they cannot argue with that because they
sense.
Can't argue with your feeling. And then be prepared to give them some resources. There's a lot of resources available. There's gamblers' hotlines. New York State has a gambling
mm-hmm.
hotline. It's an 800 number.
Mm-hmm.
There's Gamblers Anonymous, which is free
yes.
and very available. There are all kinds of, there's a program called GamPro
mm-hmm.
on Long Island that specifically works with people who have gambling addiction.
Okay.
And there are all kinds of resources now available.
What they need a lot of really is support. So for those in our viewing audience, support is a major thing, right? If you have a family member or friend, or if you yourself, you know, are having an issue, it's important really to seek help, because these things, once we, again, are very debilitating. They can lead to aberrant behaviors,
mm-hmm.
crime.
And
illness, yes, and lead
mm-hmm.
to other types of addictions. And for our family members who grow up in a household, the children see this kind of behavior, and we don't want them to think that this is something that's okay, because these behaviors can be passed along, and
Absolutely.
We just have to be very careful about how we handle things. Well, I think this has been a very good talk. We touched on some new things. We know that there are a lot of different resources out there for people who wish to gamble and who have a gambling addiction to use, whether it's the new online stuff that people are doing now, or if it's a brick and mortar gambling casino. The options are out there, so we really just have to make everybody aware of what to look for, those signs and symptoms that we discussed today, so there'll be better outcomes for more people.
And this show is part of that. It's letting people know that there's help available and there's things they can do, and I appreciate you doing this.
Well, thank you very much for coming to speak
to
me today, Ms. Lorraine. All right. So once again, my name is Julie Black Peart, and we've been discussing gambling today on Health Center from Downstate Medical Center. You stay well. Take care.